Turn with me to Jeremiah 47. We're getting close to the end of the book here. And in chapter 47, well, we started this last week in chapter 46, last time we were in here, where chapter 46 begins a series of judgments that God is pronouncing upon the nations, all right? Remember, God's held Israel to a different standard, hasn't he? No doubt about it. God has upheld Israel, he's given them his law, and he's held Israel to a certain standard. But he's also told us in Genesis 12 that everybody that, you know, that curses you will be cursed. Everybody that blesses Israel will be blessed. And so we're seeing here these nations now being indicted for pretty much their treatment of Israel. Much of these countries that we're looking at, starting with chapter 46 when we looked at Egypt, have been these kind of perennial enemies of Israel. So in chapter 47 now to 49, which we're going to cover here tonight, we're going to look at seven countries primarily that are contained in these passages here, where there's judgment of God being pronounced upon them. There's a word that God has given to Jeremiah to share with these nations. Remember in Jeremiah chapter 1, and I just realized I don't have my Bible up here, so I got to get that. I think it's right here. I think I got it right here. Okay. Oh, my word. What's that? No, yes, this idea, it's for looks. It's to show that, okay. So I feel so disorganized today. So pray for me. Let's pray that the Lord just blesses his time. This is not a good start, but all right. But God's going to do his work here. So, okay. So at the beginning of Jeremiah chapter 1, remember what God had said to him, and I'll see if I can find it here. Again, along with the theme of not being organized. Sorry about this, but let's see here. Let's see if I can find it. Verse 10, see, I've this day set you over the nations and over the kingdoms to root out and to pull down, to destroy and to throw down, to build and to plant. Just before that, he says, behold, I put my words in your mouth. So God's not just called Jeremiah to be a prophet to Israel, which primarily he was, but God told him right in his very commission of Jeremiah in the first chapter that I'm going to put my words in your mouth and I'm going to use you to be a mouthpiece to all the nations and to all the kingdoms. And there will be some that will be needed to be rooted out, to be plucked up in a sense here, to be destroyed and be thrown down. And much of it's going to be because of the way these nations have behaved and because of what they've done with God, the one true God of Israel, and by what they've done to Israel as well. And so God's judgment is coming down upon them. So we're going to see seven oracles here tonight against these smaller nations. And many of them are neighbors of Judah, of Israel here. And most of them were vassal states of Nebuchadnezzar here now. And then, of course, plotting rebellion against them. Here's a map here. And so here's some of the countries we're going to be looking at. Philistia, not listed there, the Philistines. They're going to be on the right by the Mediterranean Sea there. We're also going to hear about Moab. And if you can see Moab, kind of center, you know, of that map there. Above them, Ammon. And so we're going to be addressing Ammon, then Edom below them. Then we're going to move on to Damascus in Syria. And then we're going to hit Kedar, which is just kind of right in the center of that map as well. And then Elam. Elam's going way over to the right above that Persian Gulf there to the right, out to the east of Babylon there. So can you guys see those spots? So those are the countries that we're going to be looking at here today. So let's get into it. Chapter 47, verse 1. And we read here, this is a word to the Philistines, to Philistia, the word of the Lord that came to Jeremiah the prophet against the Philistines before Pharaoh attacked Gaza, a main city in Philistine territory. Thus says the Lord, behold, waters rise out of the north and shall be an overflowing flood. They shall overflow the land and all that is in it, the city and those who dwell within. Then the men shall cry and all the inhabitants of the land shall wail at the noise of the stamping hooves of his strong horses, at the rushing of his chariots, at the rumbling of his wheels. The fathers will not look back for their children lacking courage, because of the day that comes to plunder all the Philistines, to cut off from Tyre and Sidon every helper who remains, for the Lord shall plunder the Philistines, the remnant of the country of Kaphtor. So the Philistines, again, these were people that were a regular thorn in the flesh of the Israelites. We've heard many stories about their battles against the Philistines in the Old Testament. And, of course, one of them being David and Goliath, and the battles going on there, of course. So Israel had gained control over them during the reigns of David and Solomon, but then as the kingdom was divided, there was kind of a change, or the balance of power would go back and forth between these two nations, the Philistines and Israel, of course. Now, the enemy that's in view against the Philistines is, of course, Babylon. And all through the book of Jeremiah, we're really seeing God is allowing this nation to be raised up, and this is his chosen instrument that God is using for judgment. Not only against Israel, yes, they came against Israel, Judah, and Jerusalem, and sacked them. We covered that in chapter 39. But also he's using the Babylonians in a great way to go against these nations and to bring about his judgment. Doesn't mean that Babylon's getting a get-out-of-jail-free card. No, God's going to come against them, no doubt about it, because they're a wicked, evil people too, but God is choosing to use these people to carry out his judgments right now. So here's these guys coming. They're being likened right there in verse 2 to like these floodwaters. Waters rise out of the north. There'll be an overflowing flood. This nation's going to come against Philistines, and it's just going to be like this flood of water coming in to where they barely have time to respond or to react, and it's just going to overwhelm them. Overwhelming them so much so that it tells us there in verse 3, that the fathers will not look back for their children lacking courage. They're going to hear in verse 3 the sound of stamping hooves and strong horses, the rushing of chariots. It's going to just freak them out, overwhelm them, and fathers are going to be running away, leaving children behind. What kind of fear does that? But this is the kind of fear that is gripping these people. I mean, I may do that in a race for the ice cream truck, leave my kids behind, but not in this kind of situation, not in the you know, heat of battle and war here. It's almost unimaginable, but this is kind of the devastation that's coming against them. They're lacking courage, it tells us. Now, it says at the end of verse 4 that these are the remnant of the country of Kaphtor. That is speaking of the island of Crete there in the Mediterranean. You can see it just off to the left of the map there at Crete. And so this is where the Philistines originated from. They originated from this place, this island, and they moved into the land of Canaan. And so this is where the Philistines originally came from. Look at verse 5. Baldness has come upon Gaza. Ashkelon is cut off with the remnant of their valley. How long will you cut yourself, O you sword of the Lord? How long until you are quiet? Put yourself up into your scabbard. Rest and be still. How can it be quiet? Seeing the Lord has given it a charge against Ashkelon and against the seashore, there he has appointed it. So we see baldness has come upon Gaza. Just so we're clear, baldness is not a sign of judgment, all right? Can I get an amen from some of you? Okay, not a sign of judgment, but this is what people would do in an act of mourning or grieving, and they would cut themselves. Now, this was not a practice that God had ordained. Israel was told and forbidden not to do that, even back in Jeremiah 16, verse 6, that they were not to do these things. So these are kind of pagan practices that people would do as an act of mourning and grieving. And Jeremiah here, interestingly, is seen as somewhat sympathetic even to this mortal enemy of Israel. Because notice in verse 6, O you sword of the Lord, how long until you are quiet? Put yourself up in your scabbard. It's like Jeremiah saying, Lord, can you just put the sword away? Lord, it's enough, is it not? Can it just be put away right now? It's sort of Jeremiah's plea, but yet he realizes, how can it be quiet in verse 7? You see, Jeremiah realizes that God must carry out his sovereign plan, and we must trust him to do what is best, shouldn't we? Even when we don't understand, there are things that God is going to do that we don't always understand. And we have to be willing to be in that place of submission and say, Lord, you go ahead and carry out all that you desire. Because I know that ultimately that's going to be for the best. Though I may not understand, though it might even grieve my heart, Lord, I know that what you do is good all the time. And Jeremiah is giving way and yielding to the Lord here. There he is appointed it, it says. Now, for you historians, the date of this event is uncertain. It tells us in verse 1 that this word came to Jeremiah before Pharaoh attacked Gaza. Now, we're not sure exactly when he did. Some believe it was around 609 BC when Pharaoh Necho attacked Gaza, perhaps coming back from different fighting and stuff that was going on. We do know that Nebuchadnezzar destroyed Ashkelon, another chief city in Philistia, in 604 BC. So this event would have been before that and could have very well been 609 BC, in case you were wondering. So let's move on here now. Chapter 48. Now we turn to Moab, all right? Against Moab, thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel. Now, let me stop right there. The Moabites, who remembers who the Moabites were or where they came from? Anybody want to take a stab at it just for fun here tonight? You don't have to. Moabites were the descendants of Lot in that ill-fated plot of his daughters. Remember when they escape out of Sodom and Gomorrah? Ah, we're not going to have any lineage. We're going to have nobody to carry on our name. So they go and they have children with their father, Lot. All right? And so Moab was one, and then Ammon was the other child that was born to the other sister. And so, we're going to see Ammon mentioned later. These became, of course, enemies of Israel. Now, in this chapter, chapter 48, there's over 20 different cities and places mentioned by name in this chapter. About 85% of them will be pronounced probably incorrectly by me, just so you know. But we're going to be going through a lot of different names. But it goes to show, doesn't it, that the Lord takes great detail in what is going on, and he takes great account as to what is going on. You're not just throwing out some general kind of judgment saying, yeah, you people over there, I've heard. No, he knows exactly what's going on, and he's naming specific places. God takes great detail and great account into all things that are going on. We understand that nothing is hidden from the Lord, that the Lord sees all that is happening, and everything is going to be brought to the light before God. Now, the country of Moab, as you can see, was east of the Dead Sea. It's modern-day Jordan today. It's separated by Edom on the south and from Ammon on the north there. So let's look at this again here. Verse 1, continuing on, it says, woe to Nebo, for it is plundered. Kirjathaim is shamed and taken. The high strongholds is shamed and dismayed. No more praise of Moab. In Heshbon, they have devised evil against her. Come and let us cut her off as a nation. You also shall be cut down, O madmen. The sword shall pursue you. A voice of crying shall be from Horonaim, plundering and great destruction. Moab is destroyed. Her little ones have caused a cry to be heard. For in the ascent of Luhith, they ascend with continual weeping. For in the descent of Horonaim, the enemies have heard a cry of destruction. So Moab will also be slated for a Babylonian invasion now. As we read on, we're going to see the reasons why Moab is in this state. So let's pick it up in verse 6. It says, flee and save your lives. And be like the juniper in the wilderness. In other words, just kind of get out of there and go out into the desert where you can just kind of be on your own and flourish and grow there. Just get out of Moab here, in a sense, is what it's saying. And notice this in verse 7 here. I said we're going to get to the reasons why they're in this state and why they're receiving judgment. Verse 7, for because you've trusted in your works and your treasures, you also shall be taken, and Chemosh shall go forth into captivity, his priests and his princes together. And the plunder shall come against every city. No one shall escape. The valley also shall perish, and the plain shall be destroyed, as the Lord has spoken. Give wings to Moab, that she may flee and get away, for her city shall be desolate without any to dwell in them. Cursed is he who does the work of the Lord deceitfully, and cursed is he who keeps back his sword from blood. So Moab became a product of pride. Here's their situation. Notice that there, because you trusted in your works and your treasures. All right, we're going to see later on here, continuing on that, these were a prideful people. They thought they had it all. And what were they doing? They were trusting in their own works and in their treasures, in their riches. But they're going to be forced into captivity and stripped of it all. All these things that they are trusting in, putting their confidence in, is all going to be taken from them in a heartbeat. And then the question is, what good are these things now for you? It's a great question we need to ask ourselves. What are we putting our trust in? What are we investing in? Are we investing in things that are going to perish, that, that the moth can come in and destroy? Or are we investing in eternal things? Are we putting our confidence in the Lord alone, living for him, serving him? These people were not doing it, and they're going to sadly pay the price for it. They haven't lived a life of trust in the one true God. How would we all fare if everything that we had was taken from us? How would we fare if everything that we had right now that we stocked up is taken from us? Are we trusting in these things for happiness, for comfort, for our very existence? Is this what we're living for? Or are we living fully abandoned unto God? Now notice, these people here were idol worshipers. They weren't just trusting in themselves. They completely turned from God and worshiped false gods. One of them is named here, Chemosh, in verse 7. Notice, Chemosh was their god, and now he will be taken away into captivity. He shall go forth into captivity, it says. You know you have the wrong god when your god can be taken from you and stolen away and led into captivity. You know you're worshiping a false god when your god is stripped away and led into captivity. You got the wrong god at that point. You realize that, right? It's like when Laban came and pursued Jacob. Remember when Jacob finally said, enough is enough. I'm taking Rachel and Leah and we're going. And Rachel took all of her father's idols, shoved them in the pack as they cruise on. Laban caught up to them. He's like, what have you done, Jacob? Why'd you do this? You've taken my daughters. But I love what he says in Genesis 31:30. He says, you know, you've done all this awful stuff. You've taken my daughters. But then he says, but why did you steal my gods? It's like, right? Why did you steal my gods, Jacob? I've lost. What kind of gods are these? What good can these gods be if they can be stolen from you, you see? Any god that can be stolen is not a god that should be worshipped. And so Chemosh is being likened to this idol being taken away into captivity. Her priests and his princes together as well. Now, looking down to verse 10 there, notice this here. It says, cursed is he who does the work of the Lord deceitfully. Now that word deceitfully, I mean, that certainly applies. I mean, we can apply that today to people that are doing a work in the name of the Lord, but it's with deceitful motives. It's with an ulterior agenda, looking to maybe gain riches for themselves, popularity, fame for themselves. Doing these things in the name of the Lord, there are charlatans today doing just that. So we know that that fits, no doubt, that word. But this idea here in context and this very word has with it the meaning slackness. In other words, cursed is he who does the work of the Lord in slackness. In other words, this here is the word for Babylon. Again, that instrument of judgment that God was using to come in and sack Moab and to bring judgment upon them. God is saying, listen, you're cursed if you go about this in a, you know, haphazard way, in a sense. He's saying, care this judgment and do it thoroughly. And don't keep back the sword. Cursed is he who keeps back his sword from blood. Now, not to over-spiritualize this, but I think we can apply all this truth for ourselves. Have we carried on in the work of the Lord in a haphazard way? Have we been serving the Lord just kind of half-heartedly, just sort of like, yeah, you know, I might do this or I might do that, and yeah, I'll see if I have the energy to go and do this. Have we been serving the Lord in a slack kind of way? This is exactly what God is saying here. Have we kept back? Have we held back the sword? Not the sword that does damage, but the sword of the Spirit, the Word of God. Have we held back the sword in our lives? Have we given up daily devotions? Have we faltered in this way? Have we put the Bible to the side and says, yeah, I'm too busy with other things right now? These are important things to do, to say, I want to live my life where I am serving the Lord. And I'm doing it because it's an exciting, joyful thing to do. I want to do it wholeheartedly and not in slack. I don't want to hold back the Word of God in my life. I want to continue on with the sword of the Spirit, doing a work in my life that cuts through the stuff that doesn't need to be there, but also instructs and teaches and encourages me. Let's not hold back in these things. Continuing on in verse 11, Moab has been at ease from his youth. He has settled on his dregs and has not been emptied from vessel to vessel, nor has he gone into captivity. Therefore, his taste remained in him, and his scent has not changed. Therefore, behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, that I shall send him wine workers who will tip him over and empty his vessels and break the bottles. Moab shall be ashamed of Chemosh, and the house of Israel was as the house of Israel was ashamed of Bethel, their confidence. How can you say we are mighty and strong men for the war? Moab is plundered and gone up from their cities. Her chosen young men have gone down to the slaughter, says the king, whose name is the Lord of hosts. Now, here's another indictment against them. They put their trust in themselves, their own works, their treasures. But here's another word against them. They've rested on their laurels. They've been at ease, it says. They've been at ease from their youth. They're living in a region where there's a mountainous, you know, region beside them on the west, and then to the east is the Arabian Desert, as you can see. So they lived in a manner where it was very hard to come against them and attack. You know, they lived in these natural settings that they just kind of felt like were safe, you know. They lived at ease from their youth, it tells us there in verse 11. This was their situation, their condition. And they're compared to the winemaking process. Moab was wine country here, all right? A lot of vineyards in this area. But you see, in making wine, the wine was poured in a vessel, and then the dregs, or the lees, as you can also call it, not the family we have in the back here, but, you know, the lees, the dregs would begin to settle from the wine as the process was being done there. And the dregs would sit, and you see, these dregs would begin to sour, and it would begin to give flavor and you know, taste to the wine. But if those dregs were allowed to sit there, they would continue to just become bitter and more bitter, and it would corrupt the taste of the wine, in a sense. So what they had to do was they had to pour the wine in, let it sit for the right amount of time, a sweet aroma would come, and then they would, you know, take that and pour that into another vessel, being sure to leave the dregs behind, and then they would see, you know, more of the dregs just kind of begin to settle, and that same process would take place, and they'd have to pour it out again. So it was a repeated process that would come. If it was allowed to just sit and settle, that wine would be ruined, it would be sour, it would be bitter, it would just not be good. And this is exactly what these people of Moab have been doing. They've been sitting back. They've been at ease. They've just sort of continued on. Their scent has not changed, it says in verse 11. That's that process there. And so what does God say? He's going to bring people in that's going to tip him over and empty these vessels, break the bottles that should have been done a long time ago. You know, we don't like getting tipped or rocked, do we? But you know, sometimes that's the Lord's method to empty of us of that which might cause us to become sour or bitter, perhaps. It's when we're being poured out that we can see pride and complacency fade. If we remain in this spot and we just kind of rest on our laurels, you know, or the sayings, they've settled on their lees. That's where this idea comes from. This is the process, this idea here behind it. Settled on their lees or resting on their laurels. If we allow ourselves to do that, then we easily become just stagnant. We become bitter. We become sour. The Lord desires to do that work in us where he can tip us. He can pour out in us. And it allows us to see a change, to see complacency fade. Perhaps pride is there that needs to get kind of left behind in the dregs, you see. We don't like it. It's not always fun, but it's needed for the Lord to keep us in that place of usability, keeping us fresh, keeping us that sweet aroma for the Lord that we can continually be used for him. Let's not be those that are settling in ease or resting on our laurels, allowing bitterness and sourness to kind of creep in. Let's continue to allow the Lord to be pouring us out, using us as he desires for his purposes, for his good. There's great blessing that comes from that. We don't always realize that. We kind of shy away from it. We sort of push it away going, I don't like that pouring out process. It's uncomfortable, yeah. But the fruit of that, the blessing of that is very rewarding. Continuing on in verse 16, yeah, it says though, I was just in verse 13, Moab shall be ashamed of Chemosh as the house of Israel was ashamed at Bethel, or ashamed of Bethel. Now that account happened when Well, it's going back to when the kingdom of Israel divided. And I remember when Jeroboam led a rebellion into the north, and he thought, well, I got to set up some places of worship here in the northern kingdom, or else people are going to go back to Jerusalem, where the proposed place, the right place for worship was. People are going to go back, and they're going to want to stay remaining in the southern kingdom. So Jeroboam set up a golden calf in Bethel in the south, and Dan up in the north. And so people began to worship the gods, and Jeroboam says, here is your God that brought you out of Egypt now. And they began to worship this golden calf again. Crazy. And you see, remember, it was the northern kingdom that was led into captivity first by the hands of the Assyrians, God's instrument of judgment in 722 BC. So the Assyrians come in, lead them astray, or lead them into captivity, I should say, and they're leaving Bethel ashamed that they would ever follow after a god like this. So this is the account that's being referred to. And so Moab, just as Israel was ashamed of Bethel, Moab will be ashamed of Chemosh, this god that they worship that did nothing for them. Verse 16, the calamity of Moab is near at hand, and his affliction comes quickly. Bemoan him, all you who are around him, and all you who know his name. Say, how the strong staff is broken, the beautiful rod. O daughter inhabiting Dibon, come down from your glory and sit in thirst, for the plunderer of Moab has come against you. He has destroyed your strongholds, O inhabitant of Ar or Leah. Okay, that one. Stand by the way and watch. Ask him who flees and her who escapes. Say, what has happened? Moab is shamed, for he is broken down. Wail and cry. Tell it in Arnon that Moab is plundered. Verse 21. And judgment has come on the plain country, on Holon, on Jazah and Mephath, on Dibon and Nebo and Beth Diblathaim, on Kirjathaim and Beth Gamul and Beth Meon, on Kirioth and Bozrah, on all the cities of the land of Moab, far or near. The horn of Moab is cut off, and his arm is broken, says the Lord. Now, Moab used to be strong, right? But now, notice the strong staff is broken in verse 17. It's broken. The horn and the arm, verse 25, were symbols of strength. But now they're broken and cut off. Their strength is gone because their strength was placed in the wrong things. Understand that, guys. Where do you draw your strength from today? Where are you placing your trust for strength today? Because if it's not in the Lord, it can easily be cut off, broken down, and we're left with nothing. Psalm 28, verse 7 says, the Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusted in him, and I am helped. Therefore, my heart greatly rejoices, and with my song, I will praise him. May we be those that are putting our trust completely in the Lord, that he is our strength. That we recognize that I am weak, but he is strong. And in my weakness, his strength is made known to us. Strength is sufficient for us. His strength helps us. He alone is all that we need. There's nothing in and of ourselves or around us apart from the Lord by which will be a strength and a help to us. The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusted in him, and I am helped. And look at the byproduct. My heart greatly rejoiced. And boy, we just sing along because we're just excited that we're not having to rely upon ourselves. We rely upon a God who is all-powerful and is a strength to us. Look at verse 26. Again, coming back to Moab here. Make him drunk because he exalted himself against the Lord. And Moab shall wallow in his vomit, and he shall also be in derision. For was not Israel a derision to you? Was he found among thieves? For whenever you speak of him, you shake your head in scorn. You who dwell in Moab, leave the cities and dwell on the rock, and be like the dove which makes her nest in the sides of the cave's mouth. We have heard the pride of Moab. He is exceedingly proud of his loftiness and arrogance and pride and of the haughtiness of his heart. I know his wrath, says the Lord, but it is not right. His lies have made nothing right. Therefore, I will wail for Moab and I will cry out for all Moab. I will mourn for the men of Kir Hares, O vine of Sibma. I will weep for you at the weeping of Jazer. Your plants have gone over the sea. They reach to the sea of Jazer. The plunder has fallen on your summer fruit and your vintage. Joy and gladness are taken from the plentiful field and from the land of Moab. I have caused wine to fail from the wine presses. No one will tread with joyous shouting, not joyous shouting. From the cry of Heshbon to Eliela and to Jahaz, they have uttered their voice from Zoar to Horonaim, like a three-year-old heifer, for the waters of Nimrim also shall be desolate. Verse 35. Moreover, says the Lord, I will cause to cease in Moab the one who offers sacrifices in the high places and burns incense to his gods. Therefore, my heart shall wail like flutes for Moab, and like flutes my heart shall wail for the men of Kir-Hares. Therefore, the riches they have acquired have perished, for every head shall be bald and every beard clipped. On all the hands shall be cuts, and on all the loins sackcloth. Verse 38, a general lamentation on all the housetops of Moab and in its streets. For I've broken Moab like a vessel in which is no pleasure, says the Lord. They shall wail, verse 39, how she's broken down, how Moab has turned her back with shame. So Moab shall be a derision and a dismay to all those about her. For thus says the Lord, behold, one shall fly like an eagle and spread his wings over Moab. Kerioth is taken and the strongholds are surprised. The mighty men's hearts in Moab on that day shall be like the heart of a woman in birth pangs, and Moab shall be destroyed as a people, because he exalted himself against the Lord. Fear and the pit and the snare shall be upon you, O inhabitant of Moab, says the Lord. He who flees from the fear shall fall into the pit, and he who gets out of the pit shall be caught in the snare. For upon Moab, upon it I will bring the year of their punishment, says the Lord. Okay, that was a mouthful there. Are you still with me, everybody? All right. A lot of verses there that we just covered, but interestingly, going back to that, where we started there in verse 26, the Lord says to make Moab drunk, right? And then let him wallow in his own vomit. It's not a nice picture, is it? You know, you're just like drunk, you're just out of it, you're vomiting, and then you're just kind of like swimming in this. You know, it's not a pleasant picture here, right? Good thing I haven't had dinner yet, but it's a good picture of what pride is like. Because again, this is one of the big indictments against Moab, isn't it? We've seen that repeatedly as we've read through this here. Pride is just like that because it intoxicates us with that which is ultimately going to destroy us or be a ruin to us. There are many people that have been puffed up with pride to only have it all come crashing down. And the humiliation of that far outweighs anything we gained in that momentary pride. Just like when a person is drunk and they think everything's great. The humiliation, the depression that comes in the aftermath far outweighs any joy that a person may have received in that momentary drunkenness, which oftentimes they don't even remember anyways. Well, it says there again that in verse 40, behold, one shall fly like an eagle and spread his wings over Moab. Again, this is speaking of that Babylonian invasion. To Philistia, they're going to come in like floodwaters. But here now, they're going to come in like an eagle to Moab and just have their wings spread right over the nation and just come and reduce it to fear and panic there in verses 41 and 42. All of this again, as it says in verse 42, because Moab exalted himself against the Lord. That was the big problem with Moab. Pride. They began to exalt themselves. It wasn't just pride that they thought they were great. It's that they thought they were even greater than the Lord. They exalted themselves here against the Lord, above the Lord. Proverbs 16, verse 18 says that pride goes before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. Well, these guys in Moab are living that out right now. Great pride, exalting themselves, haughtiness of heart here. But now we understand that great destruction is right at the doorstep now. And a great fall is awaiting them. It's the same thing that applies to us when we begin to live our lives with a confidence in ourselves. It's nothing more than pride, isn't it? Having a pride that we think we're all that we got everything taken care of. We don't even need the Lord anymore. We just know what we're doing and we're just going to make it happen. It's pride. And it leads to a great fall. Let's finish up the chapter, verse 45. Those who fled stood under the shadow of Heshbon because of exhaustion. But a fire shall come out of Heshbon, a flame from the midst of Sihon, and shall devour the brow of Moab, the crown of the head of the sons of tumult. Woe to you, O Moab, the people of Chemosh perish, for your sons have been taken captive and your daughters captive. Yet I'll bring him back I will bring back the captives of Moab in the latter days, says the Lord. Thus far is the judgment of Moab. It's amazing, isn't it, that even in the heaviness of this judgment now, God gives a word of promise and hope to these people? Right, the last verse there? That in the latter days, and that's ultimately speaking of the kingdom reign on earth of Jesus Christ in the millennium, tells us that God says Moab will be restored. They will return. He will draw the captives back, it says to Moab. Aren't you so grateful for the grace and the mercy that's extended to us by the Lord? That we too have a future and a hope when what we truly deserved was the judgment of God. We're no different than Moab. We've fallen in the same kinds of traps, the same kind of sin as Moab did, as Philistia has. And we deserve judgment just like these people, but yet we understand that God provided a way for us. And we have a future and a hope. He's restored us and redeemed us in and through his son, Jesus Christ, by him taking the judgment of God for us. What a blessing that we have. I'm so grateful for that. Now, Moab's judgment here was not necessarily because of its treatment of Israel, though we know that they were enemies of Israel, that they weren't always there doing good and helping Israel by any means. But their judgment was widely due to their own pride, complacency, arrogance, and haughtiness of heart. All those things are mentioned there in verse 29 even. And he's exceedingly proud of his loftiness and arrogance and pride and of the haughtiness of his heart. The Talmud reads, if ever a man becomes proud, let him remember that a mosquito preceded him in the divine order of creation. I think that's good. Whenever we get proud, boy, there's a lot of things that God can use to quickly humble us. But Richard Newton said this. He gave a neat history of pride in three small chapters. He says, the beginning of pride was in heaven. The continuance of pride is on earth. The continuance of pride is on earth. And the end of pride is in hell. This history shows how unprofitable it is, and that is very true. Okay, chapter 49. We're going to move on to a message about Ammon. Now, Ammon sat to the north of Moab. It's, you know, the present day city of Ammon would be in this region, Ammon, the city in Jordan. So it's to the north of Moab. Again, brothers here, Moab and Ammon originally. Going back to Genesis and the situation with Lot after Sodom and Gomorrah. So here's now a message about Ammon. It says in verse 1, against the Ammonites, this says the Lord, has Israel no sons? Has he no heir? Why then does Milcom inherit Gad and his people dwell in its cities? Therefore, behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, that I will cause to be heard an alarm of war in Rabbah of the Ammonites. It shall be a desolate mound, and her villages shall be burned with fire. Then Israel shall take possession of his inheritance, says the Lord. So a question is asked regarding Israel's heir. Now, the reason for this is linked to their indictment, because what happened is in 732 BC, Tiglath-Pileser III of Assyria led away these Transjordan tribes of Israel. Remember, Gad, Reuben, and the half-tribe of Manasseh decided not to go into the promised land. They said, we're going to dwell out here. We like it out here. It's, we don't want to enter into Canaan territory. And so they remain on the east side of the Jordan. They didn't enter into the fullness of what God had for them. And so they were led away as captives even before the northern kingdom was, 732, by Assyria. So Ammon now is right in that region. And so they're looking at all this thinking, hey, look at that. We got some free territory here. So they move in now and they took Gad. Not only that, they settled their god Milcom there. That's the mention of Milcom. This was their god. This word in Hebrew means their king. It also goes by the name Molech, as many of us, I'm sure, have heard more so in the Old Testament, the god of Molech, where people would sacrifice their children to. So Ammon took land that was not theirs to take, but now they're going to have their land taken from them. Notice it says that Rabbah, one of their chief cities of the Ammonites, will have heard an alarm of war, and it shall be a desolate mound now. And Israel will also be brought back to their inheritance. Again, this is God's land, nobody's to take it from him. This is God's land, and he's going to bring his people back there. Verse 3, wail, O Heshbon, for Ai is plundered. This is not the Ai that we remember in Joshua when the city, they weren't able to overtake it there in the land of Canaan. This is a city that's in Ammon. So Ai is plundered. Cry, you daughters of Rabbah. Gird yourselves with sackcloth. Lament and run to and fro by the walls. For Milcom shall go into captivity with his priests and his princes together. Why do you boast in the valleys, your flowing valley, O backsliding daughter? Who trusted in her treasure, saying, who will come against me? Behold, I will bring fear upon you, says the Lord God of hosts. From all those who are around you, you shall be driven out, everyone headlong, and no one will gather those who wander off. But afterward, I will bring back the captives of the people of Ammon, says the Lord. Now, the people are being called here to mourn and lament because they're going to be driven out. And even their God, again, will go into exile. Again, they got the wrong God being taken from them, stolen, led into captivity. This is not the God that you want to be worshiping, putting your trust in. But Ammon, again, struggled with the sin of, what? Pride. Same with Moab. They were brothers, after all, or cousins, depending on how you want to look at it, right? Okay, either way, it fits. But again, after declaring judgment now for their pride, for their treatment of Israel, all they've done, God ends with another word of hope. And he says there in verse 6 that I will bring back the captives of the people of Ammon, says the Lord. This remnant of Ammon will return. Amazing how God continues to show grace in these times. Verse 7, we're moving on now to a message about Edom. And the Edomites, they were descendants of somebody? Esau, thank you. Edomites, they came from Esau. They had an ongoing, tumultuous relationship with Israel. And there's a whole book in the Bible written about the Edomites. Anybody want to take a stab at that one? The book in the Bible all about the Edomites is found in the book of Obadiah. Thank you. Obadiah. All right. Obadiah, smallest book in the Bible. But it's all addressed to a nation other than Israel. It's addressed to the Edomites here. So the Edomites settled in the mountainous region south of the Dead Sea. And these guys too, the Edomites, they were a prideful people, and they're going to be brought low. There are many parallels even of this word from Jeremiah as to what we see written in the book of Obadiah. Okay, verse 7, against Edom, thus says the Lord of hosts, is wisdom no more in Teman? Has counsel perished from the prudent? Has their wisdom vanished? I kept trying to say vanished because I'm famished right now. But the word is vanished. All right. Flee, turn back, dwell in the depths, O inhabitants of Dedan, for I'll bring the calamity of Esau upon him, the time that I will punish him. Verse 9, if grape gatherers came to you, would they not leave some gleaning grapes? If thieves by night, would they not destroy until they have enough? But I have made Esau bare. I have uncovered his secret places, and he shall not be able to hide himself. His descendants are plundered, his brethren and his neighbors, and he is no more. Leave your fatherless children. I will preserve them alive, and let your widows trust in me. So right in there in verse 7, Teman is mentioned. Teman was a city in northern Edom, and it was a city that was renowned for its wisdom. Wise people were here, yet nobody is going to be left there. In other words, kind of the question is posed, were these people not wise enough to understand that destruction is coming, that God's judgment is at hand? Were they not wise enough to see these things coming? Has counsel perished from the prudent? Has their wisdom vanished there in verse 7? And God says in verse 9 that as the grape gatherers would come, as important as it is for them to get all the grapes, to get everything they can, they're gleaning and they're going to want to get all they can. Even they will leave some things on the vine. They also liken it to thieves that come in by night. They're going to come and just destroy it, but they're going to take only what they can handle. They may even leave things behind. And it's being compared to saying, the Lord is saying here, when I come, there's nothing that I'm going to leave behind. Esau will be made bare in verse 10, it tells us. God is saying that he will come with judgment and it will be much more thorough. You think the gleaners do a great job. You think the thieves come and take everything. Well, they don't. But I'm going to come and show you that I will take everything. Yet, he will be gracious to spare the helpless orphans and the widows that will turn to him. Let your widows trust in me, and he will take care of them. God's heart is always for those that are kind of the downcast, the pushed aside, the fringe in a sense, right? The orphans, the widows, God's heart is always for these people of that. And even here in this nation that's deserving a judgment, God's saying, I'm going to take care of them. If they will put the trust in me, I will be a help to them. It's amazing. I love that. Verse 12, for thus says the Lord, behold, those whose judgment was not to drink of the cup have assuredly drunk. And are you the one who will altogether go unpunished? You shall not go unpunished, but you shall surely drink of it. For I have sworn by myself, says the Lord, that Bozrah shall become a desolation, a reproach, a waste, and a curse. And all its cities shall be perpetual waste. The Lord says here in verse 12 that those that have had a drink of this cup of the wrath of God that were not supposed to, did. There were those that it wasn't really, you know, the intent for them to partake of this cup of judgment, but because of their sins, they did. They perhaps were those nations unrelated to Israel. But now, how can Edom, here's the question being posed, how can Edom, a nation that is related to Israel, close ties to Israel, the brother of Jacob, and who have acted harshly towards Israel, how can this nation now go unpunished? They certainly knew better. And so they will certainly drink of this cup of judgment. If other nations had to do it, that were less deserving, how much more will Edom have to do so? Drink of this cup of judgment. And that cup oftentimes is an image, a picture of judgment throughout the Old Testament. It'll be a cup of trembling to nations that have turned against God. But you know, this cup is the very cup that Jesus took for us. Remember Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane prayed three times, let this cup pass from me. Matthew 26 tells us, let this cup pass from me. He prayed because Jesus understood this was speaking of the judgment of God. If there be any other way, Lord, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. See, this is the very reason why Jesus came to this earth, was to take the wrath and the judgment of God that we deserve, that we could be forgiven and stand righteous before God. Imagine that, people, us. Born in his sin, corrupt people are able to stand righteous before God. Why? Because Jesus took that cup that we deserved. He bore our sins. He allowed his Father to judge our sins upon himself so that we could be forgiven. That's amazing, isn't it? May we be thankful for that work he's done for us every minute of the day, every second. May not a day go by that we're not thankful for the very grace that has been extended to us. It's amazing grace, isn't it? Look at verse 14. I have heard a message from the Lord, and an ambassador has been sent to the nations. Gather together, come against her, and rise up to battle. For indeed I will make you small among nations, despised among men. Your fierceness has deceived you, the pride of your heart, O you who dwell in the clefts of the rock, who hold the height of the hill. Though you make your nest as high as the eagle, I will bring you down from there, says the Lord. Edom also shall be in astonishment. Everyone who goes by it will be astonished, and will hiss at all its plagues. As in the overthrow of Sodom and Gomorrah, and their neighbors, says the Lord, no one shall remain there, nor shall a son of man dwell in it. Behold, he shall come up like a lion from the floodplain of the Jordan against the dwelling place of the strong. But I will suddenly make him run away from her. And who is a chosen man that I may appoint over her? For who is like me? Who will arraign me? And who is that shepherd who will withstand me? Therefore, hear the counsel of the Lord that he has taken against Edom, and his purposes that he has proposed against the inhabitants of Teman. Surely the least of the flock shall draw them out. Surely he shall make their dwelling places desolate with them. The earth shakes at the noise of their fall, at the cry its noise is heard at the Red Sea. Behold, he shall come up and fly like an eagle and spread his wings over Bozrah. The heart of the mighty men of Edom in that day shall be like the heart of a woman in birth pangs. So God here calls the nations together ultimately now to come against Edom. Edom will be a nation that will be brought low. Again, it's in stark contrast to the feeling of invincibility that they had, right? They dwelt in strong natural defenses. They made their nest as high as the eagles, right? This no doubt has Petra in mind. Petra in the region of Edom. Those of you that are going to have a chance to go to Petra in February, March, it's exciting to walk through and to see these high and narrow, you know, rock cliffs and to see this what was a fortress to these people, an impenetrable fortress now. And so this is what Edom was putting their confidence in, you know, building their nests as high as the eagles, and yet they're going to be brought low now. They'll be overthrown, similarly to Sodom and Gomorrah. Again, it's pride that's at the root of their sin. Look at verse 16. Your fierceness has deceived you, the pride of your heart, O you who dwell in the clefts of the rock. It's pride again. You know that pride is at the root of most sin? Someone has said this: it's my pride that makes me independent of God. It's appealing to feel I'm the master of my fate. I run my own life. I call my own shots. I go it alone. When I'm conceited, I'm lying to myself about what I am. I'm pretending to be God and not man. My pride is the idolatrous worship of myself, and that is the national religion of hell. Pride is really at the root of so much of our sin, because sin is really a focus on self, and that's what pride is, isn't it? It's about glorifying self. It's about exalting self. It's about us saying, I'm so great. I'm so awesome. Isn't that what happened to Satan? He allowed pride to come in and wanted to be exalted like the Most High. It caused him to be cast down. May we see the warning here, because it's really in so many of these nations that are being judged here. It's what's at the root of so much of this pride, causing them to turn away from God, causing them to exalt themselves, to put up idols of their own making and doing. And judgment is coming, and they're going to be brought very low as a result. Again, pride goes before destruction. Look at verse 23 here. We see a message about Damascus. Verse 23, against Damascus, Hamath and Arpad are shamed, for they have heard bad news. They are faint-hearted. There's trouble on the sea. It cannot be quiet. Damascus is growing feeble. She turns to flee, and fear has seized her. Anguish and sorrows have taken her like a woman in labor. Why is the city of praise not deserted, the city of my joy? Therefore, her young men shall fall in her streets, and all the men of war shall be cut off in that day, says the Lord of hosts. I will kindle a fire in the wall of Damascus, and it shall consume the palaces of Ben-Hadad. Now, Damascus is, again, that oldest city or oldest inhabited city in the world. It's the capital of Syria. Hamath and Arpad were also major cities north of Damascus. They're mentioned in verse 23. And they would be shamed at the rumored ruin of Damascus. Now, we're not sure when this took place exactly, but we do know that there is still a future and yet greater fulfillment of this, because Isaiah 17:1 tells us this: the burden against Damascus, behold, Damascus will cease from being a city, and it will be a ruinous heap. We understand and know that today Damascus has never ceased from being a city. It's never become a fully ruinous heap. It's a fully functioning city today. And it's interesting to see all the things going on in and around Syria today. It seems like Isaiah 17 is getting closer to being fulfilled by the day. Certainly a place to have your eye on. Better yet, let's keep your eyes on Jesus, all right? He never changes. He's our hope. He's our strength. That's what we need to keep our eyes on. All right. Next, we move on to a message about Kedar and Hazor, verse 28. Let me bring up that map again, because Kedar, you'll see, is kind of right in the middle of the map, and Hazor is another area just north of it. It's not on that map there, but right near it. So this is, they're being lumped together as one. Verse 28. Now these were Arab tribes and some of the descendants of Ishmael, Isaac's half-brother. Again, it's a people that would be antagonistic to Israel. So against Kedar and against the kingdoms of Hazor, which Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, shall strike. Thus says the Lord, arise, go up to Kedar, and devastate the men of the east. Their tents and their flocks they shall take away. They shall take for themselves their curtains, all their vessels and their camels, and they shall cry out to them, fears on every side. Now these people here were a nomadic tribe, living out in tents, raising sheep and camels. They were enjoying their Arabian nights, right, when suddenly fear was just on every side of them. Overtook them again. And again, we'll see a little bit more clearly why here they're under this judgment. Look at verse 30. Flee, get far away. Dwell in the depths, O inhabitants of Hazor, says the Lord. For Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, has taken counsel against you and has conceived a plan against you. Arise, go up to the wealthy nation that dwells securely, says the Lord, which has neither gates nor bars, dwelling alone. Their camels shall be for booty, and the multitude of their cattle for plunder. I will scatter to all winds those in the farthest corners, and I will bring their calamity from all its sides, says the Lord. Hazor shall be a dwelling for jackals, a desolation forever. No one shall reside there, nor son of man dwell in it. So here again, like I said, we see the reason for the judgment. Notice they were a wealthy nation in verse 31, and they were dwelling securely. Now, that in itself is not a wrong thing. God has blessed nations. God has caused nations to dwell securely and to have wealth. But this bred self-reliance. They weren't living for God. They didn't need God. Everything was fine. They didn't have to have gates or bars built up. They were dwelling alone. They had no need for anybody, let alone any need for God, you see. They dwelt alone. So when Nebuchadnezzar came, they quickly realized just how foolish they were. And no one will be left to reside there any further. You know, this is a good reminder for us. Are we being those living isolated lives? Are we liking to dwell alone? Do we kind of say, I don't have any need for people. I don't want to, you know, serve anybody. Are we living self-reliance? Because understand, the Christian life is best enjoyed when we live it as God intended, and that is to live with a complete trust and dependency on the Lord, to live as servants of God and to serve others, to love the Lord your God and to love others as yourself. That's the way that the Christian life is best enjoyed. And there are a lot of people that I see that say, you know what? Yeah, the church, no, I'm just done with that. I don't need it. I don't need anybody. I'm just better off just dwelling alone. And they isolate themselves, you see. Sometimes their excuses are, well, you know, I'm just not getting anything out of it. The question is, what are you putting into it? Don't go to church thinking, oh, this is just to meet my needs. We're together as a family and as a body of Christ to where we have the opportunity to serve one another, to bless one another. And in so doing, guess what we're doing? We're blessing God. We're serving him in the process. That's what brings great joy. Too many people have pulled themselves out of the game, said, I'm better off on my own, only to see that in isolation, they actually just kind of fizzle out. There was one such man that had stopped coming to church, and so the pastor went to pay him a visit. The pastor just sat down, didn't say a word, and leaned over to the fire. Grabbed a stoker, and he just began to pull a little ember away from the fire and just let it sit. And the man that was being visited sat there and was wondering, what in the world is going on? What is this pastor doing? Soon as he watched that ember just begin to burn out, he quickly realized, you know, we're only staying lit and on fire as we remain close in the fire together. As soon as we separate, you see, we tend to burn out. That's what happens to so many people, you see. And these people were living alone, saying, yeah, we're good. We don't need anybody. We don't need the Lord. And yet judgment is coming, and they're going to see the error of their ways. Let's look at a message about Elam. Last group here now. And Elam, as you can see on the map, is way over to the east, to the right. They're about 200 miles east of Babylon. They're out there, all right? They're out there in Podunk country in a sense now, all right? And it eventually became part of the Medo-Persian Empire today, what we know as Iran. God gave Jeremiah this prophecy early in the reign of King Zedekiah. So it's probably around 597 BC that this word comes to Jeremiah. It tells us here in verse 34, the word of the Lord that came to Jeremiah, the prophet against Elam, in the beginning of the reign of Zedekiah, king of Judah, saying, thus says the Lord of hosts, behold, I will break the bow of Elam, the foremost of their might. Now the Elamites were well known for their archery skills. This is why God's saying, hey, guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to break their bow. The very thing that they're putting, again, their confidence in, what they're relying on for their strength. This was their greatest strength, yet it'll be of no help against the Lord's judgment. Their greatest strength will be broken. I will break the bow of Elam, the foremost of their might. John Corson said this, God's principle is always brokenness. It's when we're weak that he can show himself strong. His strength is infinitely greater than our strength. Therefore, if we're trusting in our bow, be it occupationally, financially, relationally, it's our bow that he'll take away. When your bow gets taken away, gang, it's not by an angry God who says, I want to destroy you, but a loving father who says, I see that your bow is giving you a limited false security, and I love you too much for that. I think that's so right and fitting here. There are many things that we could be relying on, holding on to, thinking this is what I need to keep going. And yet if it's something that's apart from the Lord has every right and oftentimes needs to come and break that. And it's in that time of brokenness that sometimes we realize, what am I truly living for or putting my trust in? It's in that time of brokenness that we understand that God is all that we need, that he is to be that source of strength and help in our lives, that he is to be the one that we're ultimately living for, being reliant and dependent on. God loves us too much to continue on in things that are not of him, and that simply breeds a false security, like Pastor John said here. He loves us too much. God's not allowing brokenness into your life to hurt you, to cause you to struggle along. He does it because he loves you, because it's in that brokenness that we ultimately find strength and grace in the Lord. Like Paul would say, that your grace is sufficient for me. For when I'm weak, then you are strong. And that's what we need to see in these times. Okay, let's finish it up here. Verse 36, against Elam I will bring the four winds from the four quarters of heaven, scatter them toward all those winds. There shall be no nations where the outcasts of Elam will not go. For I will cause Elam to be dismayed before their enemies and before those who seek their life. I will bring disaster upon them, my fierce anger, says the Lord. And I will send the sword after them until I have consumed them. I will set my throne in Elam and will destroy from there the king and the princes, says the Lord. But it shall come to pass in the latter days, I will bring back the captives of Elam, says the Lord. God will bring all this judgment to pass. And notice it says that he will set up his throne in Elam. Now, this was a common thing to do. Whenever a nation would come in and invade and overtake another nation, that they would set up a throne to their king. The victors would set up their king's throne in the city gate and kind of declare that there's a, you know, new boss in town now, in a sense. And yet the Lord says, I will set up my throne in Elam. And this is what God wants to do in our hearts, isn't it? He wants to establish his throne, which is his rule in our lives. Have we submitted to that, or are we resisting? Are there areas in our lives that need defeating? Because if we're holding on to things in our lives that aren't of God, then it's going to be defeating to us. If we're holding on to things in our lives that are not of God, it's going to cause us to be defeated. Rather, we can say, Lord, I need you to come and set up your throne in my life. I need you to rule and reign in me. So those things that are tripping me up can be defeated. And I can then walk in that victory and joy that you desire for me. And that comes when we're willing to surrender to the Lord. When we yield to the Lord and say, God, have free reign in my life. Take over. And tear down those things that are not of you, that I can walk in your victory and walk in that joy and in the fullness of life that you have for me, God. That's what he desires to do for us. We can continue on in our pride, self-reliance, and subject ourselves to that judgment of God. Or we can say, God, I'm yielding to you. Lord, I'm giving everything over to you so that I can have you reign in me and allow you to carry me on in your victory and in your life. That's the better way. So seven nations down here tonight. Next time, we're going to pick it up in chapter 50 and hopefully wrap up the book of Jeremiah. And we move on to the next nation that two chapters are covered for the judgment that's for them. And it's the judgment of Babylon. So that's next time, chapters 50 and 51. And then chapter 52 will bring again a review on the fall of Jerusalem. Okay, so let's wrap it up in prayer here tonight. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your word here tonight. And we've covered a lot, and I pray that of these things that we've read and studied and discussed, Lord, that there will be truth supplied to our lives. God, that you will have taken your word and just poured it into our hearts, and that, Lord, we would have allowed you to do a work in us here tonight. God, I pray that you would help us to live lives that are completely dependent on you. God, if we have struggled with pride, if there are those here today that are continuing on in that, Lord, I pray that you would root that out of us, that you would break that stronghold in our lives, and that we would surrender to you and say, God, I am nothing apart from you. Come into my life and have full control, have full reign. Lord, let that throne of my heart be occupied by you and you alone, God, that I can walk in that victory that you have, that I can walk in the joy, the fullness of life you have for us. Lord, may that be the case here tonight. Do that work in us. Thank you, God, for loving us. Thank you, Lord, for giving us a future and a hope in you. God, just continue to lead us on from here tonight now. That we'd walk in your ways and shine brightly for you in all that we do. We ask in your name, Jesus. Amen.